May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Did you notice any theme in our readings this morning? Death, right? There's a lot of death in our readings this morning. It's All Saints Sunday. This is a Sunday that we remember those who have died, who have departed this life in faith. It's also All Saints Day. So often, we always celebrate All Saints Sunday close to November 1st, whatever Sunday falls after November 1st. But today, we're celebrating it on November 1st, which is great. It also means that we're right on the heels of Halloween, where there's lots of little ghosts and goblins running around looking for treats. Death is a big theme this time of year. So it's little wonder that I have been thinking about my experience of death. I'm in my fifth decade of life, and I have lost someone important to me in four of the five decades. When I was 12 and 14, when I was 26, in my early 30s, and in my early 40s. And what I've noticed over the years about experiencing the loss of someone close to me is that there are various stages I go through in accepting this new reality. And while I'm speaking about my own experience here, I think this is by no means unique to me. I think you will find that this resonates with you as well. There is the initial shock when we find out that someone we love has died, where the reality of what has happened doesn't square with the one that we know to be true. I know this person that I love is alive, and I know they are dead. Those are two things that are really difficult to reconcile. It takes time for our mind to get that squared away and integrated. Then there's this phase of forgetting and remembering. I will go from thinking about them and wanting to connect in some way. Maybe I've seen something that reminds me of them. And then there's this split second shift where I remember that they are gone. So the grief is always coming up. It's like my unconscious mind hasn't fully understood the new reality. Similarly, I found that I see the person who has died a lot, particularly as I am going about the mundane stuff of my life. The grocery store, the post office, in a parking lot, anywhere, when I'm not really thinking about anything, I see someone who's obviously not the person that has died, but I think for just a moment that it is. Oh, there he is. And then I remember, no, he's gone. It's just someone who looks like him or reminds me of him in some way. All of this is our minds trying to integrate loss into a new reality. It's relentless. It's a relentless experience for some time, always bringing up the loss and propelling us back into our grief. I don't know if this is true across the board, but for me, I have found that it gets more pronounced and lasts longer as I get older. I might have gone through this for a couple months when I was 12 or 14 or in my early 20s. But at 41, this went on for over a year. I imagine the closeness to a person also affects the amount of time it takes us to integrate this new reality. Does this sound like your experience at all? I bet this is what Martha and Mary were dealing with. I can so understand what is going through their minds when they said to Jesus, "If you had been here, our brother would not have died." Now, something you may not know is that earlier in this chapter, Mary and Martha had sent a message to Jesus, asking Jesus to come and help when Lazarus was sick. But Jesus said that Lazarus' illness was an illness that would not lead to death, but to the glory of God. So he took his time. At least that's how it sounds in the gospel. But for Martha and Mary, after four long days, the finality of death was pretty hard to deny. They were in the beginning stages of reconciling this new reality of life without their brother, someone to whom they were very close. When Jesus finally comes to Bethany and sees what is happening, the mourning and the tears, the gospel tells us twice that Jesus was greatly disturbed in spirit. It also tells us that Jesus was deeply moved and that he wept. That's supposedly the shortest verse in the Bible, by the way. And Jesus wept, or in some versions it says, Jesus began to weep. Jesus then prays, thanking God for hearing him, and he tells Lazarus to come out. Lazarus comes out of the grave, and Jesus tells the people to unbind him from these claws that he's been wrapped in for his burial, to unbind him and let him go. Now, there's a lot going on in this gospel. It is a foreshadowing of Jesus' resurrection, and it is one of the signs of John's gospel that reveals to us the glory of God. It is also a gospel that maybe a little bit more quietly expresses so clearly something about the nature of God. I think most of us have been taught that God is all-knowing and all-powerful. Then, if that's the case, if God is all-knowing and all-powerful, it's not much of a stretch to place upon God the responsibility for the death of a loved one. To say things like, well, it was his time, or God has a plan for her life, or even more painful, questions about why God lets this kind of suffering happen. Why does God allow this person I love to suffer? Is this punishment for something he has done? If God loved us, this wouldn't have happened. All of this sounds a little bit like Martha and Mary's words to Jesus. If you had been here, our brother would not have died. The God to whom we assign responsibility for the death of a loved one is the God who is apathetic to our suffering. It is the God who is removed from us, who enacts God's master plan, no matter who we are or what it means for us. That, to me, is the definition of apathy, and it's certainly not loving. Our God is not apathetic. Our God is a God of love. Our God, made visible to us in the life of Jesus, is a God who weeps with those who mourn. Our God is a God who is greatly disturbed and deeply moved by our grief and sadness and distress. This is who Jesus was, and this is who God is. God mourns with us, God feels the pain of our loss, and is in it with us. When you love somebody and they're going through a rough time, you feel for them. Imagine what that is like for God, whose love is so far beyond anything we can really imagine. Today is All Saints Sunday, the day we remember those who have died in faith and who are now resting in the peace of God. Their Christian witness and their ministries and the ways they have touched our lives. This is what we celebrate today. It's also the day that we bring new saints into the church through the sacrament of baptism. So at 10 o'clock, we're going to be baptizing three little babies. All the saints, past, present, and yet to come, are celebrated today. But what we are celebrating more than that is the love of God, which is so perfect and so complete. It's a love that knits together the body of Christ into an eternal communion of saints, of which we are all blessed to be part. A love that weeps with those who weep and rejoices with those who rejoice. A love that does not end when we die, but rather a love that transforms our lives into eternal life with our loving God. Happy All Saints Sunday to all of you who are saints of our church. Amen.